specialize in recruiting kind of .NET developers across the Wasatch front. Saw an opportunity with Alan and Will and a few others just to kind of get the .NET community kicked back off here locally. So I'm very excited to see all of you here. It's going to be a great time. And if you guys have any questions, let us know. Just to give you an idea, if you guys didn't see it, we are live streaming this as well. So if you have anyone that wasn't able to make it, if you want to shoot them a text real quick, they're more than happy to jump online and take a look at it. It's got about a 30-second delay. And then if you guys miss anything, we're actually recording it as well. And I'm going to be sending out a link on Meetup probably tomorrow with a recording so you guys can take a look at it in case you guys missed anything or anything like that. I'm going to turn the time over to Will and then Jake, and we'll get started. Go ahead, Will.
I'm Will. I am a development manager at Health Equity. I'm not a recruiter, although I do a little recruiting for every now and again. Just a couple of housekeeping things. First of all, thanks everybody for coming to Health Equity for this. We really appreciate you coming, and we're glad to share our building for this purpose. We think Salt Lake needs a .NET user group, so we're super happy that you're here. As far as security issues, just wanted to mention, please don't go through the glass doors outside of here. They actually aren't necessarily locked, but they should be, and so please don't go out into the company and look around. The restrooms are, those are okay. Other than that, super glad to have everybody here, and we have Jake Garner here to talk to us about .NET Core tonight. We're really excited about that. And we're still trying to get some feedback from somebody who knows how to make those side television screens work. So as soon as I get that, we'll turn them on.
Jake, knowledge of your Jake Garner.
So before we introduce Jake, we just want to plug our sponsors. Of course, as one of them, I like to plug myself. But Dealer Track's awesome. All these companies are awesome. Health Equity, Tech Systems, Pearl Site, they all make this possible. They provide the food, the location, the swag. So we want to make sure they have an opportunity to just give a little plug here. So Dealer Track, that's where I work. We're hiring right now. It's a great place to work. We make automotive software. If you're looking or interested, feel free to contact me. Also, I want to plug Pearl Site. They've provided a lot of swag. Over here on this table, there are pens and what else have we got here? Pens. We've got 1 month subscriptions to Pearl Site. The pens are really cool. They have an LED light in them. And they're also providing some year-round subscriptions from Pearl Site.
Just a quick shout out from Pearl Site. We are also hiring.
Who's not hiring?
There we go. We got it in. So, and we'll be giving out prizes probably around 7:15, 7:30. So, Jake, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Thanks for having me. My name is Jake Garner. I'm a principal software engineer currently. I say currently because we're all software developers here, right? We know how that works. I'm at Dealer Track, so a great place to work. The reason .NET Core comes up is we've been working with .NET Core, let's see, 7, 8, 9 months now. It's actually a really cool product. I'm excited to show you kind of what we've learned so far. It's been a fun adventure. Before that, a lot of ASP.NET, MVC, Web API, WCF, you know, going back to the WinForms. So that's kind of me in a nutshell. Let me flip slide decks real quick. Is there anything else on these slides we needed to cover?
Later.
Okay.
What's the streaming URL?
Feedback if I open that up. Great view of the top of my head. Good to know. So there's the streaming URL. Well, again. Anyway, let's see here. That works. All right, so I'm gonna stand up for a second. I wanna know about you guys real quick, okay? So, real fast. How many of you are familiar or use .NET Core? Raise your hand. Okay, this is good, decent amount. I'm gonna be asking you guys for great answers. All right, next question. What dev environment do you use? How many of you are developing on a Windows machine? Okay, decent amount. How many are developing on a Mac? Another decent amount. How many of you want to develop on a Mac? Wait, sorry, bias. Everyone, close your eyes. All right, now how many? Okay. Anybody on Linux? One guy. All right. The always one. And the next question, what do you use .NET for? Are you, how many of you are developing Windows apps currently? Couple around. How many of you are in ASP.NET, MVC, Web API? Okay, that's good. WCF, a few, Silverlight. Okay, just curious. Any mobile developers here? Xamarin? Okay, a decent amount. Primary language, C#. Anybody in F#? A couple. VB? Okay, that's good.
Close your eyes.
Yeah, close your eyes again. All right, so I'm going to do a little overview of .NET Core. We'll do a few slides just to kind of introduce some of you. We won't go in-depth too much because we want to crank out some code, and we will definitely do that. So I see a lot of machines. Hopefully, you know, we're developers. If you need a machine and you don't have one and your neighbor does, hover over their shoulder. But, you know, we prefer face-to-face, so maybe just tell them what you're doing, right? So, okay, what is .NET Core? Am I okay here? Can you? Okay, yeah, I'll do business. So .NET Core is a cross-platform version of the .NET framework. So what does that mean? It means you can build, develop, run, you know, Windows, Mac, Linux, multiple environments. It's open source, so Microsoft has adopted this open source world we live in. 5 years, 10 years ago, I never would have thought I would have heard that, but here we are. So .NET Core exists in C#, some F#. They say VB is coming. That's in their docs.
I'm switching around on you, sorry, man.
You good?
I got glare on the screen, so the stream is coming
through. Okay.
There we go.
All right.
Is that okay, everybody?
Yes.
Sure. Thanks.
The workflows, so with .NET Core, currently we have console apps, ASP.NET Core, and Windows 10 UWP. Primarily, our demo will focus on ASP.NET Core and a little bit with console apps. So first things first, it implements the .NET standard library. How many of you are familiar with the standard library? A handful. Which is normal. So basically, when they started .NET Core, they had a subset of APIs from the .NET framework. And the .NET framework is, it's pretty decent. The problem is those of us in WPF and WinForms and ASP.NET, you know, we were working with the base class libraries. And then .NET Core came along, and then we had the core library, and then Xamarin came along, and now we've got the mono class library. And so developers are trying to toggle and balance between learning all these different APIs. And Microsoft recognized that this is a problem, and so they decided to create one library to rule them all. It's the .NET standard library. And this is probably one of their biggest initiatives right now, is is getting the APIs into the .NET standard library. They're the next release 2.0, they're basically going to double their footprint of APIs, and that's awesome because this is one of the biggest hurdles to using .NET Core. All right, so I'm going to sit down for a second and start driving. So then the question comes up is, well, how do I know which API is in the standard library? So Emil Landworth is a product manager for the base class library, and he maintains this web page called APIs of .NET. So I'm going to jump over here real quick. So it looks like this. So you can do a search here, and basically, like their example, kind of start searching. We'll see how the internet and his API works right now. And his search isn't always the best.
I'm not seeing your screen.
You on your screen?
Oh. You guys wanted to see it? Come on. All right, let me back up. So his homepage looks like this. Many of you should recognize this a little bit. Click on search. So he's got a search term or a text box here. And you can just kind of start typing here. So like string.length. And if you scroll down, here, he's got this declaration section. And so in .NET Core, it was in version 1.1.1. The .NET framework, it was introduced in 1.1. .NET standard. So I can see pretty quick that, all right, I can use string.length. Many of you, though, like me, work with third parties and other older technologies. We have one we're working with right now that uses XML SAML authentication. And so, you know, can I use .NET Core for this? So I happen to know that, because I looked it up, like a good developer, identity model.tokens. So I can kind of search for this. And I can see, all right, it was introduced in the .NET framework in version 3.0. It's up through 4.6.2. It's in mono. It's not in .NET standard. So not necessarily the, you know, I'm not going to be able to use it with .NET Core. It doesn't exist yet. But keep your eye on this website. I'm hoping he keeps it up to date because the footprint of APIs is growing all the time. So when should you use .NET Core? Oh, come on. Okay, so use .NET Core when you have cross-platform needs. You're targeting microservices. I thought this was interesting because Microsoft has said with .NET Core having kind of a smaller footprint, it's really good for microservices. It also, with some of the Docker and the containerization, the cross-platform stuff, it really comes in handy. Also in a polyglot environment, it works really well. So yeah, Docker containers. If you're using Docker containers, .NET Core works great for that. And I thought this one was interesting. If you need high performance, Microsoft claims that ASP.NET Core is 10 times faster than classic or ASP.NET MVC. And so I thought that was kind of interesting. Of course, being engineers, we want to figure that out for ourselves. And I would encourage you to do that and let me know what you figure out. And it works really well side by side. You can have different versions of .NET Core running alongside each other. So when should you use the full .NET framework? So you should use it if your app currently uses the .NET framework. So Microsoft has said, keep using it, extend it, don't migrate yet. And then these next kind of three bullet points are basically, if you have third-party libraries, NuGet packages, there's technologies or a platform that doesn't support .NET Core, don't use it. I thought that was kind of an obvious statement, but. So to sum up, when should you use .NET Core? If you're doing something new and the libraries support it, use it. Otherwise, stick with what works. So their roadmap, they've got 2.0 coming out in spring 2017 of both the .NET Core and the .NET Standard. I think this is probably, they should have a lot of the tooling kind of caught up. Right now, as you'll see as we dive in, some of the tooling is a little bit behind. It's come a long way, though. When it first came out, it was a mess. It was interesting, but the tooling's come a long ways, and the .NET Standard is it's got a much bigger API footprint now, so it does a lot more. Okay, so ASP.NET Core, what is it? Well, they basically took ASP.NET from the ground up and redesigned it. It's no longer based on system.web. They've tried to keep it kind of as lean, modular, componentized as possible, and you pull in NuGet packages when you need it. It can run on .NET Core, or you can actually target it for the full .NET framework. It consists of modular components. It's cross-platform, so you can run it on Windows, Mac, Linux, and it's open source. If you guys are feeling brave and want to go contribute or fork it, adapt it to your own needs, have at it. All right, let's get those machines warmed up. Let's create an ASP.NET Core web application. So get your machines out, fire up Visual Studio, follow along. I'll give you guys just a second. So let's do file, new project. And over here on the left, we've got templates. Under Visual C Sharp, you'll see .NET Core. Find ASP.NET Core web application. And we're going to target a web application just because it brings in a lot of those libraries up front for you. Now, we could start with a console app, and it just takes forever to pull in all the libraries. So give it a name. I know naming is the hardest part of programming, so I will uniquely call mine Web Application 17. 17A. I'm just teasing. You can create a directory, initialize it with a Git repository or Application Insights if you want. I'm not going to. So here, yeah, we're gonna do a web application. Now you can target web API or empty. Like I said, we'll just do web application for now because it does a lot of the setting up the solution folder how you want. No authentication is fine, and I'm not gonna host it in the cloud.
Question about that. It looked like you had to check the box in order to have it not in the cloud, as if being in the cloud was the default, or did I get that confused?
Other way around.
Okay.
Yep. So right now you'll notice it's restoring packages. While we wait for a minute, let's talk about the solution, what's here. First thing you see is the welcome to ASP.NET Core SS project README. You know, this is nice if you guys want to take a look at some things like Bower, Bootstrap. They've got some how-tos here, some overviews. We're just going to close that, get it out of the way. Close that. So, first thing you'll see, we've got a couple of solution folders. One here, one here. Everything basically lives inside source. We have the global JSON, kind of sets up the project, has an SDK version here. Then we've got our solution, our project, I should say. Under properties, we've got some launch settings JSON. In here, you'll notice, got some IIS settings, profiles, IIS Express and Web Application 17. That relates to, if you drop this little arrow down here, we've got IIS Express or Web Application 17. Sorry, I should have changed the name, huh? References, we've got the libraries that point to ASP.NET Core, some extensions. Now, one thing you'll see that's new, for those of you familiar with ASP.NET, is this wwroot folder. And this basically holds your static content. So you've got your CSS, your JavaScript, some of your other libraries, Bootstrap, jQuery, some of that. Let's see, we've got dependencies here. So some package management for your web client, your client libraries. Controllers and views, this should look pretty familiar for those of you already familiar with .NET or with MVC. And then we get into appsettings.json. Currently there's not much in here except for logging, but this contains your config settings, basically. Web config is down here. You don't really put anything in here. In fact, this is only used for Visual Studio and IIS. And even if you delete this and run it with IIS Express, it'll rebuild it for you. All your application or your project settings are in this app settings JSON. And then we've got bundling minification mapping here. I'm going to skip program for a second and come back to that. And we've got a project JSON. And this is kind of interesting. There's been some discussion in Microsoft about this. This originally was how they wanted to do this replaced the CS Proj. And, you know, it's kind of a, there's some neat things you can do with it. You can just type directly in here if you want a certain library, and it'll auto refresh in here. They are moving to CS Proj though. That's on their roadmap. They're hoping to do that in the 2.0 release. So I will provide documentation for that and with links later, but basically I'm gonna kind of jump back and forth between some of their documentation a little bit. They're moving to MS Build based projects in the future. So they say still use project JSON for new core projects, but down the road that'll change. README file, startup I'll get to in a second, and web config we covered a little bit. All right, so let's jump over here real quick. See if I missed anything. Any questions about the project kind of setup so far? Over here.
Things that used to be .xml files are now .json?
That's correct, yeah. They've kind of moved away from XML and have gone to JSON. So,
we'll need to go back again.
Yeah. All right, so let's talk about the program.cs. So each, basically ASP.NET Core, it's basically a console app. So let's flip over here, start in the program. Can you guys see my project? Okay. So in the program.
It's a little small.
Is it? If that helps. Is that better? Hopefully. So in the program.cs, if you comment out this stuff, what does it look like?
Console app.
That's exactly right. It looks like a console app. So let's test this out real quick. Let's start typing. Let's do like a beep or something. The any key. We'll wait for a second. We had one more line up here. Let's do this, so it'll pause for a second. So if I just run this as is, hit the IIS Express, you know, I look at it. Let's see what happens. We're developers, right? Try it out. And it opened a web page. Well, you just said it was a console app. Come on. So let's kill this. Stop it. This is where this launch settings comes in. If we drop this down, pick our web application here, and notice we've got launch browser and launch URL. I'm just going to comment those out, run it now. Okay, I got a console app. Holy. You know, let's try that one more time and actually make it so you guys can hear, because this is, holy. All right. So, we have a console app. I know, not that cool, but it kind of goes back to just it's all built on top of a console app, which I think is pretty cool. So, let's get rid of this. Let me uncomment this. Okay, so what's this doing? We've got our main. We're going to create a web host builder. Use Kestrel as a web server. Content root, we're saying for static content, go to the current directory. IIS integration, you only need this if you're going to be using IIS Express. And then use startup. So each .NET, ASP.NET needs a startup. So let's jump over there real quick. Actually, before we do that, let's just make sure we're in a good state. Get the typical pages we'd like to see. Here's my console app running, logging a bunch of stuff. All right, there's the typical kind of ASP.NET page that you like to see in MVC. We got our Jumbotron here, links. All right, so we can kill that. So let's jump over to the startup. So here in the startup is our constructor. One thing you'll notice immediately is an environment. Well, in .NET Core, environments are first-class citizens. They've really tried to keep environments in mind as they develop this. So you notice here, we back to our app settings JSON. Basically, this command is loading configs. It's also got an app settings.environment name.json. So you could say, if I want a app settings.staging.json or app settings.production, it'll run those apps specific to that. So also environment variables. So first thing it does is it loads these configs, saves it to this property here. And then we've got these two methods, configure services and configure. Let me blow this up just a touch. So configure takes an application builder, a hosting environment, and a logger factory. First thing it does is add console and add debug to the logger. So we'll get a console logger, and we'll also be able to log to the debug. Here's some more switching based on environment. And what we're doing here is adding what we call middleware. So middleware in .NET Core, these ideas that I can have a bunch of middleware, and I'll run some logic, then I'll call the next middleware piece of middleware. And at any time, I can kind of short circuit that process. And I've got a, let me make sure, middleware. So here's kind of a picture of what that looks like. So they're request delegates, they come in, middleware one, can process logic and then call next, and on, and then unwind the stack a little bit till you get your response. This makes it a nice way for you to add, you know, certain things like, well, they've got a list of built-in things, error handling, static file server, authentication, MVC, and that's kind of what you see here. Use static files, use exception handler, use MVC. You'll notice something out of the gate. Here's our routes right here in a Lambda, which I thought was kind of interesting. But before that, we have this configure services. And if you have any kind of heavier lifting, this gets called first. So here it's adding MVC. One thing that's really cool is this has dependency injection built in. So that's a really awesome feature of this. And we'll show some of that here in a little bit. Okay. Let me jump over here, make sure I'm not skipping anything. All right, so more demo. Let's get to some coding here. So first thing we want to do, let's create a model. So right click on your project file, add new folder, call this models. Let's add a class. What should we create? Widget. We'll be simple. Create a couple properties here. So I've got a model now called widget. Let's create a data access layer. I'm not going to use a database. We'll just kind of new one up and go from there. So I'm just going to add a class here. We'll be original and call it DAL. And what we're going to do is I just want to new up a widget and return it. So public widget, get widget, turn new widget, name, give me a good name. Hardest part of programming.
Clock widget.
Clock. Description. Tells time. I like it. So I know, not the coolest DAL in the world, but that'll work. Let's pull an interface out of here. We can even move it to a separate file. Okay, so now I've got a model. I've got a data access layer. We need to get that data. Let's create a controller. So we'll go add, new item, and if I come in here, click on ASP.NET, I've got a list of different templates. I'm just going to do an MVC controller, and we'll call it widget controller, create that. Now, at this point, how, in your experience in the past, how would I get my DAL into, you know, my widget controller? Well, we could new it up. We could wire up some dependency injection framework. How many of you have used some of those different frameworks? Yeah. It's not always the quickest and easiest part, and here's where you're like, all right. So .NET Core gives you a lot of this right out of the box. So if we come back to this startup, we can come right in here, say services.addTransient, and I'm going to say my interface type of DAL to my concrete type of DAL. And I'm done. So now if I jump over to my widget controller, it uses constructor DI. So now I can pass it a type of IDAL. DAL. I can introduce a value for that. So here I can say, let's say I want to create a view model and pass to this view. I can do DAL.getWidget and then pass my view model to the view. Now those of you familiar with MVC, this part hasn't changed a whole lot. We need to create a view. The tooling's not quite there. I can't just click on it and have it scaffold it for me yet. But MVC, if you know or don't, uses convention. So we need to add a new folder and call this widget. And then we can right click on widget, say add, new item. We'll just choose an MVC view, index.cshtml. We'll get rid of that. And we say app model. And then we want to point to our widget. So we're web application 17. models.widget. Now in Razor, I'm just using Razor. We can just say name. Thanks, autocomplete. And description. Now real quick, let's just come over here to our shared. Going to layout. How much of this part looks familiar? Those of you with MVC, you've kind of walked through this, create a view. I'm kind of going quick. I'm hoping some of you have done this before. I'm going to add just a link to my shared. We'll call it the controller is widget. The action was index. Give it a description. Widget. Okay, we'll save this. Let's run this guy. And you can do the IAS Express, that's fine too. I just kind of like to see what's going on. You get all your logging right here. We'll go into logging in a second. So here on my homepage, I've got my widget link. I click on here, I've got a name, clock, tells time. So we're able to pass our model down to our controller into the view. It used controller dependency injection with very minimal setup. You know, I thought that was an awesome feature of .NET Core. Now, I have a few others I want to add now that I've got this widget controller. I want logging. Well, remember back here in our startup, we added logging right here. So it's already been wired up to dependency injection. So I can come back to my widget controller in the constructor, create an iLogger, give it the type, which is the class we're in, and then give it a name. Let's introduce and initialize a field. Now, just so we can see, I'm going to do an error. So now if we run this, let's get this to where we can actually see it. Bootstrap, yes. Come click on widget. Notice immediately I get my fail log in here. So without pulling in any libraries, without wiring up any dependency injection, I get it right out of the box. I can pass it to my controllers, my methods, just using constructor injection. So another really cool feature of .NET Core. Let's see, all right. So let's create, say, well, I'm not really an MVC. I don't care about Razor. Let's add a new item here. And we're going to do a web API controller. Let's call this a widget API controller. Hit add. Now, this should look fairly familiar if you've done web API in ASP.NET before. We've got our routing as fluid attributes here, API controller, and HTTP GET. So let's one thing I want to point out real quick, web API controller inherits from controller. If I jump over to my MVC controller, it also inherits from controller. So that makes it really nice. I'm not dealing with these two huge libraries, one or the other, that have conflicting types, and it can get, you know, not very fun to play with. So let's do some more constructor injection here. We'll wire up our DAL again and our logger. Takes widget API controller. So I'm just going to use this get method. We know it's going to return a widget. Let's return dal.getWidget. And let's log while we're here. All right, now if we run this guy, you know, click here, same thing, slash widget. If we do slash API, slash widget, assuming I named it all correctly. Didn't. Oh, that's because I named a widget API. Follows convention, right? So there we get our JSON back, so your Angular can consume that. It's serialized for you. We get our logging in Web API Controller right here at the console. I thought that was pretty awesome. Now, I started thinking, all right, well, since they both inherit from controller, we can do some interesting things. So let's say I want to post a widget. We'll add a logger. But I'm going to pull it out of here. I'm going to put it in my MVC controller. But I need some routing. But let's get rid of the API. That's loading up. Okay, so first I click on widget, I get my razor back, my MVC, kind of as expected. Let's jump over to Postman. Let's do a widget. I'm gonna post this. Let's add a breakpoint in here. Going to post that, hit send, and I hit my breakpoint. I'm in my my post method, and I've got my widget. So you can do some pretty creative things mixing those controllers. I thought that was pretty cool. Now, of course, if you put your get method in there, you're not going to get your action back. You'll get JSON back, which so be careful. Let's see here. Let me jump over to the slides, make sure I haven't forgotten anything. So with dependency injection, I talked about add transient. We can also do scoped and singleton. The lifetimes here are transient or created each time they're requested. Scoped creates once per request, and singleton created the first time they're requested and reused after that. Logging, so there's several built-in providers. I showed you console. Debug I didn't show too much. That just runs in Visual Studio, you can see in your debug window. I don't like using that one because it's all the same. Let me show you that real quick. So it's flying in there. So now if I click over here to widget, okay, somewhere in there, there was an error. I was lucky and I can see it right there. But normally it's hard to find. All right, let's see here. So our built-in providers, we've got console, debug, event source, event log, trace source, Azure app service, some third-party providers are Elma.io, Logger, Nlog, Serilog, so some decent third parties. So I'm kind of running out of time a little bit, and I would love to go super deep with some of you on this. If you have questions up to this point, let's. Are there any questions that I can answer? Any from the live stream? How many of you were actually able to follow along? I kind of blazed through some of that, so I apologize.
So, most part.
Good. Any questions?
So at the start you said they said something about it being 10 times faster than regular SQL. With regards to what? Maybe you can level, but.
Yeah.
That's an order of magnitude.
That is an order of magnitude. I'll find that link for you. It's a Microsoft thing, and let me see if I have my notes in here. Because I'm not sure what they measured it against, honestly.
Talking about the speed test?
Yeah.
They were, what they did is they're measuring good response time. It's really just plain text file.
Okay.
So loading up a plain text file on the, and then loading up a paint, so creating a static file and running it with the Kestrel server and .NET Core. And basically it's just rating what the response time is using that versus using Node.js or .NET. And so, in fact, in comparison, the Node.js rates around 360,000 responses per second, whereas the .NET Core is pushing about 3.2 million. They haven't quite released the official where they're going to stand yet, but they've been really trying to push the limits to where they are going to be with the best frameworks out there.
Thank you.
It's excellent that the ASP support is there, and it's good. If you just wanted to build a web app that, say, was using HTML and JavaScript and talking to a data store in AWS, I believe you can now do all of that in Visual Studio 2017 as well. Is that right?
Yeah. So 2017 previews out there hasn't been fully released, which is why I didn't use it for the demo, but I expect that they're targeting the release with the .NET Core 2.0 and the .NET Standard 2.0. Now, they probably won't quote that anywhere, but.
Did you do that in 2015 then?
This is all in 2015, yeah. Mm-hmm. Over here.
Can you speak to the, you mentioned that there was
So, yeah, the question was around dependency injection, kind of built in. So they use constructor injection. I guess I don't need my... So notice, I'll just kind of review quickly here, where you've got, I created a concrete class here. I have a DAL. I extracted an interface. And then right in the startup here in configure services, you just add it to services. And let me point you to the documentation really quick.
So you don't need to add in Unity, correct?
No Unity, no Ninject, no simple,
just
what
built,
are the?
You just built the containers built in?
Containers built in, yeah. Yeah, I love it.
You can switch it out if you need to.
Yeah, you can. So let's see here. Yeah, their documentation actually is pretty good. And one of my goals here is to get you kind of familiar with the territory. After this, we can I'll send out links to the docs. This will really let you kind of understand a little bit what's going on. At least familiar with firing it up. You know, no reason to be afraid and dive in and figure it out. So, yeah.
At the beginning of the talk, we were talking about the JSON file that was firing up the browser.
Yep.
But you even commented out where the startup was being called. And that JSON was actually being added in the startup. So what framework, what library is actually calling that JSON file to
actually load that configuration? I don't know. I'd have to look into that a little bit further. We can maybe throw that around in the chat boards and see if anybody knows that. But what he's talking about is in my in the program, you know, I commented all of this out, yet it still read from my global.json, not that one, from my launch settings. And I'm assuming this is probably a Visual Studio kind of handled config. Probably ran that first. But yeah, so it read those settings before it launched the application. But I don't know for sure. So, Alan.
So, Jake, what's the best IDE for .NET Core? What are the options?
That's a good question. The question is what's the best IDE for .NET Core? So, depends on the environment you're working in, okay? So, on Windows, you know, there's the Microsoft products, which are Visual Studio 2015 and 2017. And one advantage of the Microsoft products is it's, you know, their tools are really tightly integrated. There are others. There's .NET Code. There's your favorite text editors. JetBrains has one that they're working on. And let's see, for the Mac, which may be where Alan's headed here. I'm a Windows guy. Alan's my boss. He's a Mac guy. And he says, or he goes, "When? How am I going to get you over to a Mac?" I said, "As soon as Microsoft releases Visual Studio for Mac, yeah. I'll switch." So, in my backpack, I now have a Mac. So, thanks, Alan. Let's go back here and then over here.
I was going to say the Visual Studio for Mac preview does have .NET Core support in it. It's still very early stages.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's a new preview sometime in the near future, but anyone that wants to try that font mod would be greatly appreciated.
Yeah, you can absolutely do Visual Studio for Mac. Try it out, .NET Core. You could clone it, run it. You could actually, the cool thing about .NET Core is it's got a CLI. You could do it all from the command line and your favorite VI or Vim or whatever editor you love coding in. So, thank you.
What you know about doing something like, you know, it's common to have a handler inject something into the pipeline, maybe a handler for adding a watermark to an image or something.
Yeah, typically those handlers are best used in the middleware component because that way...
Yeah, if you build your own pipeline now...
Yeah, you really can customize that pipeline.
It used to be there for all those events, or it's not there anymore, so you got to build your middleware. At some point, how you mesh your middleware, you can say, go do something with the
Exactly. Well, thanks, everyone. I appreciate your participation. If any of you have any more questions, I'd love to talk to you afterwards.
Real quick, I found the performance data.
Oh, yeah.
Then they actually, so in their conferences, they were kind of touting a 3 million mark. But yeah. They actually underhit it. They hit 1.8 million. But the website's techempower.com, and it actually will show you the ASP.NET Core benchmarks versus everybody else, around 13 million. So if you look at, it's called ASP, if you search the page for ASP.NET, so in that particular one that you're on, which is Fortune, it did quite a bit lower than its competitors. Go to plain text. That's the one that they really like. There you go. Click on that guy. Scroll down. There, you can see they're about 1.822.
Missed it.
Which, considering Node, we've noted it. Node's about 467,000, so it's still about three times faster than Node.js.
Thank
that's
you.
If you run on that Linux. And interesting thing is they also did multiple, so like for instance, you'll notice that the MVC is actually slower than without if you just did the static files.
Yeah. Thank you. Cool. Cool site there for some benchmarks. I'll have to dive into that later. Thanks for showing that. So,
what's the website again? Tech Empower?
Tech Empower, yep. Yeah. So yeah, I'll post my slides. I'll post links. You know, we can continue the discussion through the app or some other way. However, it's a modern age. So, thanks again. Appreciate it.
All right. Well, thanks a lot. I'm going to take just a second. We'll get to the prizes. Give away some stuff. Hopefully, everybody's excited for stuff. First off, I mentioned a little earlier that I'm a manager at Health Equity, and what I didn't mention as part of that story is about a year ago, I was an engineer. But in the space of a year, I've forgotten how to do simple things like adjust air conditioning and get screens to work in a conference room. So my commitment to you is that when we come back in 2 months, that I will figure out how to do those things. 2 months should be long enough, hopefully, for a manager.
What to do with the night before.
Right. So then I think Chris has the drawing and...